RoboCop from 1987. This could be the most violent movie I've talked about so far. It's probably a toss-up between this and Hellraiser. So, with that in mind, there will be some images of fictionalized violence in this video. So, just be aware of that. But if you haven't seen RoboCop, you shouldn't be watching this video anyway. And if you haven't seen RoboCop and can tolerate the violence, then you should go watch it right now. Because, and this might seem like a bit of a stretch, I genuinely think the original RoboCop is one of the greatest movies of all time. It's definitely one of my personal favorite movies. I put it right up there with Jaws, The Empire Strikes Back, Blade Runner, Wrath of Khan, the first two Terminator movies, Indiana Jones. I mean, to me, it's right there. And I think it's because it's one of the most unique movies I've ever seen. It's like the Swiss Army knife of movies. It's a sci-fi movie. It's an action movie. It's a comedy satire. It's a Western. It's poignant and tragic. It's a revenge movie. It has horror elements. And it's also a metaphor for the resurrection of Christ. That's Jesus, Hercule, Christ. I mean, this movie has it all. It has a lot of elements from other things, and yet at the same time, it feels very unique. It deserves to be celebrated as one of the greats. And it's funny because when people hear the title, or even if they just see the poster, they're automatically expecting it to be nothing more than a cheesy B-movie. And that's probably what it should have been. I mean, the title isn't even accurate. It should be called Cyborg Cop, you know? It has no right to be as good as it is. And I feel like most people go into RoboCop kind of the same way they go into the first Rambo movie, First Blood. You know, people just kind of expect a fairly mindless shoot 'em up, but they get something a lot deeper and more touching than they expected. And it also has a lot of Star Trek actors in it, so what's not to love, right? But I think we should probably just get started. RoboCop from 1987. Directed by Paul Verhoeven, starring Peter Weller, Nancy Allen, Kurtwood Smith, Ronnie Cox, and Miguel Ferrer. The movie takes place in a not-too-distant dystopian future. Not-too-distant from 1987, I mean. In fact, I tend to just think of it as a weird alternate version of 1987. And it begins with a very over-the-top news report, threats of nuclear war. There's an advertisement for an artificial heart, which is comically large. I mean, what organs are you taking out to make room for this thing? The Yamaha Series 7 sports heart. I mean, Jesus. There's also a crime report. A massive corporation called Omni Consumer Products recently entered into a contract with the city of Detroit to run their police force. So this is basically like if Microsoft owned the NYPD. It's now a privatized police force. It might seem ridiculous, but I'm sure there are people who might think that's a good idea, especially in the 80s. And you gotta wonder how it works. Like, do you have to pay a monthly subscription fee to OCP in order for the police to actually help you when the need arises? I don't know. I'd have to imagine there's something kind of like that, though. Which is a little unsettling, to say the least. And the report goes into a story about Clarence Boddicker, the unofficial crime boss of old Detroit. He recently killed two cops, and a third one is clinging to life. And then we get introduced to Alex Murphy. He's a new transfer from another precinct. And this particular area is riddled with crime. And none of the officers here seem to like working for OCP. There's threats of a police strike. And Sergeant Warren Reed is also introduced. He walks into the locker room and he cleans out the locker of the third Clarence Boddicker victim. He ended up not making it. Tragic. It also is interesting that this is a unisex locker room. Male and female officers are just getting changed together. And that's kind of a Paul Verhoeven thing. He does it again in Starship Troopers. I guess he just thinks that maybe people won't be as hung up about nudity in the future? Who knows? Anyway, Murphy meets his new partner, Ann Lewis, who is in the process of beating the shit out of some guy, as you do. And they head off on patrol as we jump to a corporate meeting at OCP headquarters. and it's being held by the chief executive at OCP, known only as the Old Man. And since OCP owns the police in Detroit, all these yuppie douchebags have been tasked with curing crime. In 6 months, the Old Man plans to begin construction on Delta City, a brand new city built on top of Old Detroit. But in order to start this project, they need to get rid of the crime so the workers can be safe. And let's face it, they also want to clear out the riffraff so that only the upper class will occupy the city. As I said, it's a dystopia. And we also meet Dick Jones. Yeah, his name is Dick, and he will prove that he is worthy of that name with every spoken word. He answers only to the Old Man, and he's been put in charge of cleaning up Detroit. He begins his little presentation, and he talks about how OCP has dominated in markets traditionally thought of as non-profit, such as hospitals, space exploration, and prisons. So OCP runs everything. Is there even a government, or is it just OCP? I mean, we don't even know. It's wild. And he goes on to say that the city needs a cop with superior firepower and reflexes to use it. So he demonstrates a new toy, which is called the Ed 209. It's a fucking stop-motion animated robot. This thing is a cool design, and it has my name. So how could I not have a soft spot for the Ed 209? Although I have no idea what happened to Eds 1 through 208, who's to say? But as we'll soon see, it's going to be hard to imagine them being more of a disaster than the 209. So Dick Jones asks a guy named Mr. Kinney to take part in the demonstration. Jones hands him a Desert Eagle pistol, which apparently is just on display in this meeting room. And he asks Kinney to use his gun in a threatening manner. And he does. And the Ed 209 tells him to drop the weapon and that he has 15 seconds to comply. Kinney drops the gun, but the 209 is still counting down. There's a panic until finally the 209 says that it now has the authority to use lethal force. And he shoots the ever-loving shit out of poor Mr. Kinney. I mean, it's so over the top. This is the moment that lets you know exactly what kind of movie you're in for. I mean, this guy is perforated into a pulp. It's so over the top and gory that it actually becomes funny. And that was obviously intentional on the part of Paul Verhoeven. He satirizes everything, even the violence. And after this massacre is over, someone finally pulled the plug on the Ed 209 and someone says, "Will someone call a goddamn paramedic?" And that's the icing on the cake for me. A paramedic. For what? You're better off getting a janitor with a mop. This dude is a paste. And frankly, if he's anything like the rest of these corporate assholes, it's probably no big loss. And the hilarity continues when the Old Man tells Dick Jones that he's very disappointed. As though things like this maybe aren't common, but they do happen at the workplace from time to time. And Dick Jones says that it's just a temporary setback, which again is just so funny. I mean, a man was brutally murdered here. Everyone should be in jail, but to them it's just kind of a minor inconvenience. And this is where a younger executive named Bob Morton butts in with his own idea for a robotic police officer. He calls it RoboCop, and he says it's ready to go with several candidates in mind. And much to Dick Jones's chagrin, the Old Man approves Bob's idea. He wants to see a presentation in 20 minutes. 20 minutes? A guy just got shot to shit in the office. Could we maybe take the rest of the day off? And then he tells a coworker that they can go ahead with this as soon as some poor schmuck volunteers. And we'll find out exactly what that means soon enough. And then it jumps back to Murphy and Lewis, who stopped for coffee, and Murphy is flipping his gun around, which seems highly irresponsible, especially in public. But he tells Lewis that his son is a fan of a show called TJ Laser, and this character does some similar moves after he takes down a bad guy. So Murphy practices this for his son. I mention it because it's weirdly important later on. And they get a call, there's been a bank robbery, so they head out. They chase after Clarence Boddicker and his crew, Leon Nash, Joe Cox, Emil Antonowski, and two other guys who are not all that significant, except for Bobby, who is on Clarence's shit list right now because apparently he burnt all the money when he blew up the bank vault. And somehow Clarence just didn't notice until now. And Murphy and Lewis catch up to the van that they're in. There's a bit of a shootout. And Bobby gets hit in the leg. And Clarence has had enough of this guy. He's a total liability. And he does this.
Can you fly, Bobby?
Clarence, no!
Clarence Boddicker is one of the best movie villains of all time, in my opinion. He has so many great lines in this movie. Sometimes it's almost even hard to root against him. He's right up there with Hans Gruber, in my opinion. So great. And after Lewis and Murphy scrape Bobby off their windshield, they follow Clarence and his crew to an old steel mill where they're hiding out. Lewis calls for backup, but it's not available. Figures. So they're going in. And this massive steel mill is a very common setting in the RoboCop universe. It's used in every movie. It seems like it's a lot of unused land. And it also seems like something you're more likely to find in Pittsburgh as opposed to Detroit. And that's probably because these scenes were actually filmed in Pittsburgh. At any rate, they decide to split up, which is pretty dumb. It's already 5-2. Now you're running the risk of it being 5-1, depending on who finds them all first. And Lewis finds Joe. He's taking a piss. She's about to arrest him, but she gets distracted by his dick. Yeah, that's right. He says, "Do you mind if I zip this up?" And she takes a peek. And when she does, he slaps the gun away and punches her off a ledge. And for some reason, Joe laughs like he's Ricky Gervais. Talk about adding insult to injury. I mean, if Lewis had just taken one step back and then took a peek, she'd probably be fine. But whatever. Meanwhile, Murphy has Emil cornered. He says, "Dead or alive, you're coming with me." But unfortunately, the rest of the crew show up, including Joe, who says he took care of the other cop. And Clarence says, "Murphy must be some kind of great cop to come in here all by himself." They mock him for a while, and then they finally decide to shoot the shit out of him. He gets his hand blown off, and then his arm. It's officially a firing squad execution, and yet somehow, after being riddled with bullets and shotgun blasts, he's still standing. I mean, what is going on here? This is not how physics or the human body works. But whatever. And Joe asks him if it hurts.
Does it hurt? Does it hurt?
Which is highly condescending. You know, I think even Clarence's underlings could be the main villain in a movie. Like, they're all so great. It's just, they're so evil. It's amazing. And Clarence finally puts an end to this by shooting Murphy in the head. This scene is absolutely brutal, almost to the point of it being comical. Almost, but not quite. Because after Clarence and his crew leave, Lewis shows up, and she is devastated to find her partner like this. She obviously feels guilty, and she probably should, although even if she had been there, I doubt it would have made much of a difference. I think they would have just killed her, too. So maybe it's better that she got punched in the face for trying to catch an eye full of ween. And then we jump to a hospital scene. It seems like they're trying to save Murphy. I mean, what is there to save? It's kind of crazy. And all the while, Murphy is seeing visions of his family. So despite everything, he's not quite dead yet.
There. He says he's not dead.
Yes, he is.
I'm not.
He isn't?
Well, he will be soon. He's very ill.
I'm getting better.
No, you're not. You'll be stone dead in a moment.
But of course, they can't save him. And he dies. Officially. And the screen goes totally black for a number of seconds. Which is kind of haunting. And then it jumps to the birth of RoboCop. It shows his point of view, and the lead technician is a woman named Tyler, and her glasses are ridiculously huge. It's definitely the 80s. And they're talking about him. Tyler tells Bob Morton that they've managed to save his left arm, but Morton wants total body prosthesis. And they decide that he's legally dead, so they can do whatever they want to him. And that he won't even remember this conversation because they're going to wipe his memory. So there goes his left arm. He shuts down for a while and reawakens on New Year's Eve. And all the scientists are celebrating. A drunken Tyler gives him a kiss on what looks like his eyes, apparently. Needless to say, this seems like a hellish existence for whatever is left of Alex Murphy. And he's finally ready for duty. They have him up and around, and they bring him to the police department where he settles in. And we finally get our first real look at him, and it looks great. The costume was designed by Rob Bottin, who did the makeup effects and creature designs for a lot of legendary movies over the years, probably none more famous than John Carpenter's The Thing. So RoboCop was always going to be in good hands with this guy doing the makeup effects. And they have RoboCop sitting in a chair. They show off a, quote, rudimentary paste, which sustains his organic functions. Bob Morton's buddy, Johnson, eats some of it. And he says it tastes like baby food. I mean, first of all, why would he eat it? When you see this shit dripping out of this, like, ventilation system, is your first instinct to eat it? I don't know. It seems nuts to me. And how does he even know what baby food tastes like? The last time I ate baby food, I was an actual baby, and I don't remember what the fuck it tasted like. But this guy eats enough of it to know when other things taste like it. I mean, to each his own, I guess. And they go over RoboCop's prime directives. Serve the public trust, protect the innocent, and uphold the law. And there's a fourth directive, which is classified. Even RoboCop doesn't know what it is yet. But aside from the fourth one, they're all pretty good directives. I'm a little surprised that a company as sleazy and corrupt as OCP added such useful and practical directives, although it seems like some of them might come into conflict with the others. Like, for instance, I would think that serving the public trust would sometimes conflict with upholding the law. You know, it's hard to serve the public trust if you're trying to meet your parking ticket quota, if you get what I'm saying. We also get to see them test his targeting system, and the graphics for when he targets something seems so archaic, but at the same time, I think it's really cool. Basically, what I mean is that I've always loved the 1980s idea of what the future will look like. Like, even if it's totally inaccurate, I just love it. And Bob Morton is so excited about this successful test that he grabs Tyler and kisses her, which is fucking weird. I wonder if sexual harassment in the workplace is even a thing in this world. Who knows? And they bring RoboCop to the shooting range. I don't know if real-life police stations actually have a shooting range, but they sure as shit have them in 80s action movies. And RoboCop sort of clomps his way in and really doesn't move all that fast, but it's fine because he doesn't have to. And Lewis is also in the range, and she continues shooting her target when it's literally 2 feet in front of her. I guess you got to practice that point-blank accuracy as well. Maybe she ought to slap a dildo on the front of the target so she can train herself not to be distracted by dicks. And this is, of course, where RoboCop's gun is introduced. And I've always thought the design of this thing was really great. I don't think it's a stretch to say that it's one of the most iconic sci-fi weapons of all time.
I don't know what it's called. I just know the sound it makes when it takes a man's life.
And RoboCop starts shooting the target. He's obliterating this thing. It's kind of crazy. All the other cops can't help but take notice of RoboCop, and one of them says this.
It's SuperCop! fucking gun.
In case you couldn't hear it over the gunfire, she says, it's RoboCop. She doesn't even know what the movie's called. It's RoboCop. RoboCop is Jackie Chan's area of expertise. But it's funny that she calls him RoboCop because I believe that was the original title of the movie. And RoboCop does the TJ Laser gun twirl the same way Murphy did. And Lewis takes note of that. Nobody other than maybe Bob Morton and the tech team are really sure who he is. But after seeing that, Lewis knows. And he puts the gun away inside of his leg, which is bizarre, but kind of practical given the circumstances. And they give him the keys to a squad car and send him out on patrol. And some guy is about to try to rob this convenience store. The owner is watching TV, and this weird pervert says, I'd buy that for a dollar. And this is important, because whatever this show is, it is apparently the funniest thing on TV in this world. It is all people watch. It's on 24 hours a day. Even Emil was watching it in the steel mill before Murphy and Lewis showed up. It's very popular. And the dude who intends to rob this place picks up a copy of Iron Man off the comic book rack. Nice touch, I think. And it's Iron Man 142, which I don't think is a particularly high-value comic, but I'll tell you what, it would make me want to see what else is on that rack, for sure. And maybe there's a copy of Secret Wars number 8 just sitting here. Hey, old guy, do you have any long boxes in the back? I mean, this dude doesn't even need to rob the store. Just buy some comics from this guy. But unfortunately for him, he is robbing the store. And I know that he's in a trench coat, but where the hell was he hiding this gun? It's massive. I mean, this is like a military carbine rifle he just pulled out of his ass right now. And he wants the register emptied, as well as the safe, which apparently is hidden under a bunch of beer cans, which look empty. I guess the owner was just hoping that no one would ask why there's a pile of empty beer cans in the middle of the store. But thankfully, RoboCop walks in. And when he does, there's this weird synthy sound that comes with it. And remember that, because for some reason, whenever RoboCop walks through double doors, that's the sound that plays. I don't know why. And the dude starts shooting. He has an even worse potty mouth than me. And RoboCop bends the barrel downward at a 90-degree angle. I don't know how the guy even held on to the gun while he was doing that. But either way, it certainly sent a message. And when the guy tries to run, RoboCop just kind of clotheslines him and he goes flying into the eggs. And then he just looks at the old people running the store and says, thank you for your cooperation. Good night. I hope he didn't just leave this dude here, but who the hell knows? We'll give him a break. It's his first night on the job. And he's driving around again, and you get to see how he gets informed about crimes in progress. It goes directly into his head, which is kind of cool. And it jumps to two scumbags chasing a woman down an alleyway, and they catch her, and they cut off some of her wig. Tragic. And they're about to assault her even further. But thankfully, RoboCop shows up. And this might just be my favorite scene in the movie.
He's gonna kill her! He's gonna kill her, man! He's gonna kill her!
Your move, creep.
I mean, it's amazing, is it not? He shoots through her skirt and hits a rapist directly in the dick. This entire movie is heroic. And I still don't know exactly how he was so sure that he wouldn't hit her. You know, you don't know what's going on under somebody's skirt. She could have a big fatty pubis or something. Who knows? But he took the chance, and I'm glad he did. And I love how he says, "Your move, creep." It's just another infinitely quotable line from this movie. And after it's over, the woman runs up to RoboCop, and he says this.
Madam, you have suffered an emotional shock. I will notify a rape crisis center.
I love that. I love that he's really cleaning up the streets in the most brutal ways possible, but he's also really pleasant to innocent people. He really is like if Judge Dredd had a moral compass that was closer to Superman, you'd probably end up with somebody like RoboCop. And I also love that the woman kind of pulls away once she realizes that this is not a guy wearing armor. He is the armor. And that kind of freaks her out a bit. There's some really cool, subtle stuff there. And his patrol continues, and you know, I don't see anyone in the back of his squad car, so it's safe to assume he's not actually arresting these shitheads. It seems like he just fucks them up and calls some kind of police van or paddy wagon to pick them up, which is fine, I guess. He's got a lot of shit to do, you know? And one of the things he has to do right now is head to the mayor's office, where the newly elected mayor is being held hostage by an ousted city councilman. At the time, this was probably more comical than it is today. But because of the way politics are right now, there's at least a part of me that believes that this could happen. A guy holding people hostage because he doesn't want to leave office and he wants his old job back. It's crazy, right? And yet, if something like this was on the news right now, I wouldn't be as shocked as I would have been, say, 10 or 20 years ago. That's all I'm saying. And we see this dude has already killed someone. So, I mean, obviously he's got to go down. He's talking to the negotiator outside. And he has some strange demands.
First, don't fuck with me. I'm a desperate man. And second, I want some fresh coffee. And third, I want a recount. And no matter how it turns out, I want my old job back.
I mean, how do you not love it? It's so perfect. First, don't fuck with me. Give me some coffee, and I want a recount, and it doesn't matter what the results are, I still want my old job back. It's hilarious. And he continues yapping. It's really more funny dialogue, and RoboCop approaches. He's able to see through the wall with thermal vision. So that's interesting. That probably would have been useful when he shot through the woman's skirt, but we didn't see him using it there for whatever reason. And just when the dude is about to execute the current mayor, RoboCop breaks through the wall like a deranged Kool-Aid man, and he grabs this piece of shit and he punches him into the Phantom Zone. And the camera crew is there to catch every second of it. It's outstanding. So, in his first night on the job, he stopped a robbery, a rape, and an attempted political coup. Phenomenal. And a news report on RoboCop shows him doing an interview at a local elementary school. And his advice for the kids is to stay out of trouble. Good advice, honestly, especially with this walking, talking police version of Frankenstein's monster out there roaming the streets. I mean, I would stay out of trouble with this guy on the loose. And they also show a commercial for a board game called Nukem. It says, "Get them before they get you." The satire is truly off the charts. And OCP obviously wants to use RoboCop to clean up the streets of old Detroit so that it's safe for the workers to build their new elitist city on top of it. It really seems like there's no middle class at all in this world. It's just the super rich people who make their money by oppressing poor people who are just trying to avoid getting murdered every day. So it's really a nightmare. And Bob Morton predicts that they'll see the end of crime in old Detroit within 40 days, which I think is wishful thinking, to say the least. And Morton heads to the executive bathroom, which apparently you have to scan with a key card just to get into. And he's talking with a coworker at the urinal, and he starts bad-mouthing his corporate rival, Dick Jones. But what they don't know is that Dick Jones can hear everything they're saying because he's in the stall taking a shit. Morton is pissing. Jones is shitting. I can't help but think that there's some kind of metaphor there for what they're doing to the city right now. And Jones pulls his pants up, doesn't seem to wipe his ass or anything. It's fucking horrendous. And he comes out of the stall, and everyone panics and leaves because they're terrified of Dick Jones. He's the number two guy at OCP, and he just took a number two. One guy even pisses himself on the way out the door, so that's nice. And Dick Jones walks up behind Morton, who is pretending not to be frazzled by his sudden appearance. And he tells Morton that when he was a young executive, he used to call the old man funny names, like Iron Butt and Boner. And he says once he even called him asshole, but there was always respect. I mean, was there? You didn't even respect him enough to hit him with a real insult, calling him Iron Butt and Boner. It's fucking ridiculous. And he's pissed at Bob for going over his head with the RoboCop program, which resulted in the Ed 209 ending up on the bench. He says that he had a guaranteed military sale with Ed 209, and who cares if it worked or not. So this is hilarious. This guy expects his project to succeed, even if it doesn't work. I mean, Jesus. Dick Jones could just as easily be a Disney executive. And this conversation continues, and Dick Jones slowly grabs Bob Morton by the hair and says that he just fucked with the wrong guy. Keep in mind, he just took a shit and did not wash his hands yet. And this whole dick measuring contest comes to a close after Jones tells Bob that his project better not screw up. Bit of foreshadowing, because he's about to screw up, at least in the eyes of the company. He's in his little cage at the police station, and he starts having bad dreams. Dreams about his own death. He's having weird spasms, and this is, of course, where the GIF comes from. So now he's remembering his own murder, which is actually pretty horrifying when you think about it. I mean, imagine how fucking pissed you'd be if you got murdered and they still made you come into work. Yeah, I know that's a meme. I didn't create it. Whatever. It's a good point. And then you remember your own death on top of everything. So, I mean, it must be horrific being inside Murphy's head right now. And naturally, he's pissed off. So he leaves. And all the scientists are freaking out because obviously he shouldn't be doing this. And RoboCop is stopped on the way out the door by Officer Lewis. She says, "You really don't remember me, do you?" And then she looks him right in the eyes and says, "Murphy, it's you." And he takes a step back because obviously this triggered something. But then he just keeps moving and simply says, "Somewhere there is a crime happening." And one of the scientist jerk-offs is really pissed at Ann Lewis, and I have no idea why. I think he's just looking to blame the perceived malfunction on someone else. And it kind of works. Bob Morton just yells at Sergeant Reed for allowing one of his officers to even talk to the robot man. And it jumps to a scene at a gas station. Emil is looking to fill up his bike, and he wants to do it for free, of course. So he robs the guy working the counter at gunpoint. And he gives him shit about being a college kid because he's studying some kind of geometry. And granted, he does look like he's about 35 years old, which is unusual for a, quote, college boy. But maybe he's a late bloomer. Who knows? But RoboCop shows up and he tells Emil to drop the weapon. And he says, "Dead or alive, you're coming with me." And of course, Emil remembers when Murphy said that to him, not long before they all murdered him. And he kind of flips out and says, "We killed you, you're dead." And he tries to run for it. And this causes more memories to come flooding back for RoboCop. He's glitching out a bit. And Emil shoots at him and he blows up the whole gas station, which of course does nothing to RoboCop. He ends up shooting Emil's bike and he crashes. He grabs the injured Emil and says, "Who are you?" It seems like RoboCop would like to know more.
Would you like to know more?
But sadly, Emil is in no condition to answer any questions right now. So, RoboCop heads to the computer room at the station, and another officer doesn't think he should be in here. But RoboCop does not give a fuck anymore.
Can I help you, sir?
No.
Well, what is it exactly that you want? Hey! You can't enter here! Wait a second! Hey! Just a minute!
That's the guy.
Hey, this is a restricted area!
So that's a new ability unlocked. I mean, that is the spikiest data spike I think I've ever seen. R2-D2 has nothing on this fucking thing. And I love how he basically gives old Sweet Chuck the middle finger. It's hilarious. Anyway, he plugs in and he finds Emil's criminal record. And he searches for known accomplices. We see Leon, Joe, and finally, Clarence Boddicker. And it also shows all the things that he's wanted for. And let's just say he's committed just about every crime imaginable. And he's a suspect in the murder of Alex Murphy, who, according to this, is deceased. Imagine what's going on inside this cyborg's head. He's finding out who he is and that he's dead. So, naturally, the human side of him is starting to reemerge. He heads to Murphy's home address. And it seems like there's a chance he might actually reunite with his wife and son. But they're not there anymore. They've moved out. There's a computerized realtor trying to sell the place. RoboCop walks through the house, and as he does, he triggers all sorts of memories. He sees his son watching the TJ Laser show. He finds a picture of his wife and son on Halloween. Remember, he came online as RoboCop not long after New Year's, so this picture was probably only a few months prior to that. And he walks towards the bedroom and sees a memory of his wife. And she says, I really have to tell you something.
I love you.
Master ship. Functional space with a touch of elegance.
Hey, have you thought it all over? Why not make me an offer? I mean,
holy shit, I'm about to fucking cry. What a tonal shift. And I mean that in the best possible way. It's not a criticism at all. But you're just not expecting a movie like this to hit you with an emotional gut punch like that. And it does. I don't know about you, but I really feel for Murphy in this scene. I mean, they took everything from this dude, but he's not dead yet. He's still kicking. And he's about to kick some ass. He heads to some kind of weird club to track down Leon. And people are dancing with their titties out, as you do. And Paul Verhoeven makes his cameo appearance in the movie. You see what I mean? He's a little wacky, and I love it. And RoboCop finds Leon. He demands to know where Clarence is. And Leon takes out a gun, and RoboCop just kind of smacks it out of his hand, and some random guy catches it and starts dancing with it. I mean, it might as well have been a fucking glow stick for all this guy knows. It's hilarious. But there's commentary there. I mean, you know, Paul Verhoeven is showing how guns are so commonplace here that no one is fazed by them. And then, of course, Leon tries to kick RoboCop in the balls he doesn't have anymore. And then RoboCop just kind of drags Leon out by his hair. And everyone loves it, especially Paul Verhoeven. And now it jumps over to a scene at Bob Morton's house. He's with two women who he refers to as models, but I don't think that's true. They don't really seem like models to me. They seem like hookers who are really into cocaine. And one of them says, and I quote, "Sometimes I can just think of something and it can get me so horny." I mean, something is a very vague term, don't you think? I can just think of something. And it can get me so horny. Like what? Calculus? You know, indoor plumbing? Mr. Met? Who the fuck knows? And just as Bob is snorting coke off the other one's titties, as you do. He hears the doorbell ring, and he pops up, and he has no coke on his face. I mean, this dude is a pro. And then Bob says, that must be the champagne. Now, they aren't in a hotel, so I'm guessing he just door-dashed some booze. But when he answers the door, it's Clarence, and he has a gun. And he says this.
How you doing? Bitches leave.
Gee, Bobby. Bye. You gonna call me? Oh, my God.
I don't know why that has become one of the most quotable lines in this movie, but I'm glad that it has. It's just really funny, especially the way he says it. And I love it because Clarence obviously doesn't give a shit about leaving witnesses. A paranoid criminal would probably have killed everybody here, but Clarence doesn't care. He's only here for Bob Morton, so in that case, bitches leave. And they do, and one of them asks Bob if he's gonna call her, which is weird. I mean, read the fucking room, lady. And once they're gone, Clarence shoots Bob several times in the legs. So much so that he actually says stop. I don't know why. There's just something really funny about this guy getting shot so many times that he actually has to say stop. And Clarence puts on a DVD, which I think is way ahead of its time in 1987, and it plays a video of Dick Jones. And he's basically gloating while Clarence puts a timed grenade on the table, and he leaves the house. And Bob tries to reach the grenade, but he can't, and it explodes. R.I.P. Bob Morton. And the fucking door dasher with the champagne is probably going to show up now and be like, what the fuck happened here? I guess this means I'm not getting a tip. And sometime later, Clarence pays a visit to a cocaine factory in Detroit, which seems a little nuts to me, but okay. And Clarence has some business with some drug lord named Sal. He offers Sal a lot of money, it seems, but Sal doesn't like that Clarence is working so closely with someone at OCP, basically accusing him of being in league with the company that runs the police. Clarence tries to assure him that it's nothing to worry about, and he says the Tigers are playing tonight. I never miss a game, which seems highly unlikely given the hours that he keeps. He does not seem like someone who sits around watching baseball. And I guess Leon must have led RoboCop here because he kicks the fucking door down and he says something that you might say to your romantic partner during sex while you have guests in the house.
Come quietly or there will be trouble.
And of course, they don't come quietly. No one ever wants to come quietly. Where's the fun in that? They start shooting at Robo, and he naturally starts shooting back. And this is kind of funny when you think about it. RoboCop shoots all these bad guys. But he doesn't really have to, does he? Like, their guns can't really hurt him. And yet, he is responding with lethal force. I don't know. That's just really funny to me. And most of these guys are now dead. Joe gets knocked out, and Clarence tries to make a break for it. But he doesn't get too far. RoboCop grabs him and starts reading him his Miranda rights while throwing him through glass over and over again. Clarence pleads with RoboCop by saying he's protected. He works for Dick Jones, the number two guy at OCP. And that OCP runs the cops, and that RoboCop is a cop. And therefore, he can't hurt him. And it seems like RoboCop is going to kill Clarence right here. But he remembers that he is a cop, and he shouldn't kill, at least not in complete cold blood. I mean, you wouldn't think that one more dead scumbag in this place would make that much of a difference. But he decides to take Clarence in. And he tells Sergeant Reed that Clarence is a cop killer, referring, of course, to his own murder. And now, since Clarence ratted out Dick Jones, he plans to go arrest him too. But while RoboCop is heading over to OCP headquarters, Clarence uses his one phone call to call Dick Jones and warn him about what happened. And Dick Jones says the lawyers will have Clarence out in 24 hours, which is crazy. A wanted murderer is getting out on bail, I guess. I mean, it just further shows how corrupt this world is. And RoboCop arrives at OCP. He says that Dick Jones is under arrest for aiding and abetting a known felon. And when he goes to arrest him, he starts malfunctioning. Directive 4 kicks in, and we finally see what it is. As Jones explains, it was his little contribution to his program. Any attempt to arrest a senior officer of OCP results in shutdown. He says RoboCop is nothing more than their product, and they can't have their product turning against them. And Jones brings out the Ed 209. I don't care what anyone says. I love the stop-motion animation for the Ed 209. I think it looks fantastic. It is weird, but to me, it still looks more real than a lot of today's CGI. And this is where Dick Jones further proves how much of a moron he really is. He starts giving a villain speech. He says that he had to kill Bob Morton because he made a mistake. And now it's time to erase that mistake. And the Ed 209 tries to kill RoboCop. And it's a bit of a slugfest. RoboCop is clearly damaged. And Dick Jones decides that he's going to call the police, which is kind of funny. A cop wants to arrest him, so he's calling the police, naturally. And RoboCop heads for the stairs. And the Ed 209 tries to follow, but unfortunately for him, the stairs are his mortal enemy. He takes a step and goes tumbling down. It's hilarious and sad. I mean, this is my namesake. This is my Ed. And look at it. Look how they massacred my boy. And I love that RoboCop just takes one look at this disaster and says, well, I think I'll just mosey on out of here. His name is Murphy, and he just did an Irish goodbye. And he makes it outside where he finds a whole squad of cops, and the leader says, prepare to fire. Some other cops protest, but they have orders to destroy it. It. They refer to Alex Murphy as it. And they all start shooting. And this is another really emotional scene, in my opinion. I mean, he's been betrayed by his own people now. He remembers his own murder. And now it's like it's happening all over again. It's fucking brutal. I mean, imagine being shot to death and remembering it, and then spending most of your days and nights being shot. And now, your own colleagues are the ones doing it. I mean, it's fucking horrific. And he sort of falls down a few levels in the parking garage, and he runs into Lewis, who of course helps him. She puts him in her car and drives off, and the cops start shooting at her too, which is fucking nuts. And then we get some more wacky advertisements and news reports. There's a commercial for a car called the 6000 SUX. 6000 sucks? What kind of a name is that for a car? And why is there a stop-motion animated dinosaur with eyes bugging out of its head? Why is that used to sell a car? But then again, why is a duck used to sell insurance? I have no idea. It's a commentary on goofy American advertisements. It's also a commentary on the American auto industry selling fast cars with big engines that are fine as long as you're driving in a straight line. I used to drive a Ford Mustang GT, and I loved that car. It was a lot of fun, especially when I was young. But man, the turning radius on that thing was a nightmare. There was almost no such thing as a three-point turn. It was more like a five-point turn. And it had rear-wheel drive, of course, which is not ideal during a New York winter. Fishtailing became like my favorite pastime, but it had a V8 engine, it had some horsepower, and that's kind of all that matters to some Americans when it comes to cars.
She may not look like much, but she's got it where it counts, kid.
But I think that's enough of a side quest, and I should probably get back to the topic at hand, don't you think? And there's a news report about how a satellite laser cannon misfired and killed 113 people, including not one, but two former U.S. presidents. So I think that's clearly a dig at Ronald Reagan and his Star Wars program idea. And then finally, there's a report about a police strike. They interview a homeowner who doesn't like that the police are striking. And they also interview this guy, unemployed person. And he says this.
It's a free society. Except there ain't nothing free because there's no guarantees, you know. You're on your own. There's a lot of jungle.
Well said. Anyway, Clarence strolls into Dick Jones's office. He's already out of jail, and he's wearing a new suit. The office is a mess. People are putting it back together after last night's robot war. And Clarence talks to the secretary about fitting him in. It's pretty gross. But it's funny because the actress playing the secretary is Kurtwood Smith's wife in real life, which is cool. And he heads into the office and talks to Dick Jones. Jones is pissed that Clarence ratted him out to a cyborg, and he says that RoboCop's memories are admissible as evidence. And this is exactly why Dick Jones is a moron. Because if that's true, then why the fuck did he tell RoboCop that he killed Bob Morton? He admitted to a murder that RoboCop didn't even know about. And he only did it because he was so certain that the Ed 209 was going to take him out, even though the Ed 209 has already shown that it is riddled with design flaws, as much as it pains me to admit it. So, I mean, Dick Jones is a moron. He's a total fool. I mean, and now he wants Clarence to clean up his mess. He tells him that he's going to have to kill it. And Clarence argues with him, and he makes some decent points. He says he's going to need some major firepower, which isn't a problem, because according to Dick Jones, OCP is basically the military. So he's going to supply these street criminals with military weapons now. And by the way, Clarence Boddicker is a wanted criminal still. Like, I know he's out of jail somehow, but he still must be wanted for the cavalcade of other crimes that he's committed. And he's now been seen visiting Dick Jones. I mean, I almost think everyone is a moron in this movie at times. And it turns out that Lewis took RoboCop to the old steel mill to hide while he tries to repair himself. She went back to the department and got him a new gun as well as some baby food. So it is actually baby food that he ingests. Johnson was right on the money, so that's nice. And this is where RoboCop takes off his helmet for the first time. And the black chin guard is suddenly gone. No idea where it went. It just magically disappeared. And the face makeup is really outstanding. It's creepy. It really does look like his face is just slapped on there like a mask. And he asks Lewis about Murphy's wife and son. And she tells him that after the funeral, they moved away. She thought he was dead, so they started over. And here comes maybe the saddest line in the entire movie.
I can feel them. But I can't remember them.
I mean, how does that not make you sad? It's almost soul-crushing. I mean, but it's also kind of inspiring because this fucking guy lost everything, but he hasn't lost his moral compass, and he hasn't lost his will to fight. And his voice now is a lot less robotic. He sounds like Murphy again, because for the first time since his death, he is Murphy. He has reclaimed his humanity, and he's ready to kick some more ass. And of course, with the rest of the police department on strike, there is chaos in the streets, especially since Clarence and his whole gang are already out of jail. Emile is once again watching the I'd buy that for a dollar guy, and he loves it. The funniest thing about whatever this show is that everyone thinks it's hilarious when it really isn't. Like, why is I'd buy that for a dollar the greatest punchline in the history of comedy. What does it even mean?
What do you mean? What do you mean? What do you mean?
I have no idea, but it's great. And Clarence, Leon, and Joe show up. They were not only let out of jail, but they were given a brand new 6000 Sucks car and some new weapons called the Cobra Assault Cannon, which they're obviously planning to use on RoboCop. And they test out this new toy by blowing up everything in sight. So that's good. You gotta make sure the weapons work before you head into battle, I guess. And Dick Jones gave Clarence a tracking device that shows RoboCop's approximate location. So they all head to the steel mill to try to finish the job. They show up and start looking for him, and it's not long before Murphy reveals himself. He immediately shoots Joe.
Looking for me?
What's the matter, Joe? Does it hurt?
Does it hurt? Does it hurt?
And chaos ensues. They all start shooting at RoboCop with these portable cannons, and they somehow keep missing. It's not like he's a fast-moving target. I mean, maybe if they used that massive scope that's mounted on top of this fucking thing, maybe they'd be able to hit something. But they don't. They're all just hip-firing. And Clarence gets in his Sucks car, and Lewis chases him in her squad car. Emil takes the van and tries to run down RoboCop, but he misses and smashes into a container of toxic waste. And this is the most horrendous part of the movie. I mean, where is this coming from? Needless to say, Emil is not doing well. I mean, he's in worse shape now than he was when he played that kid in a full body cast in Rocky II. And Emil, such as he is, saunters over to Leon, and he reacts like most of us would.
Don't touch me, man!
I mean, fair. That's probably exactly what I would say. But why does he just run away? I mean, Leon is a character who seems to have no issues killing innocent people. But he doesn't bother to put his piece of shit friend out of his misery. Shoot him is what I'm saying. Shoot whatever this glob of goo is until it stops moving. Because there is no treatment for whatever he's got right now. And then he kind of shuffles into the middle of the road where Clarence runs him over. And he splatters him like a fucking bug. His cantaloupe head went careening off the windshield. I am stunned by the hilarity and the grossness of this whole sequence. I mean, why does this character specifically end up getting what might just be the worst fucking death in movie history? I don't know. The only answer is that Paul Verhoeven is a wonderful madman. I mean, this whole scene is almost like something out of the movie Street Trash, which coincidentally came out the same year, and I am not at all recommending that movie. But a scene like this would fit right in with it. Although RoboCop special effects are obviously superior to anything in that movie. But if you've had the misfortune of seeing Street Trash, you kind of get what I'm saying. And this is what I mean when I say it has horror elements. Obviously, this looks horrific, but it's also a horror movie for the villains. Like, they're the promiscuous teenagers at camp, and RoboCop is cleaning house. Maybe that's a stretch, but they certainly seem terrified, don't they? Anyway, Clarence crashes his Sucks car into some rusty water, but he pops out and shoots Lewis several times, and it looks like she got shot in both titties. Tragic. But thankfully, Murphy shows up. No idea how he got here so fast. Clarence and Lewis were racing along at high speed, but somehow Murphy ended up ahead of them while he's on foot. and he doesn't exactly move fast, so it's magic. And Clarence surrenders, or at least he pretends to surrender, and Murphy says, "I'm not arresting you anymore," which is a great line, and it makes sense because it certainly didn't do any good the last time he arrested him. But Clarence's surrender was just a ruse. Leon has been operating this massive crane above them, and he drops a bunch of beams and scraps on top of Murphy, seemingly crushing him. And just when Leon is celebrating his perceived victory, this happens. And let that be a lesson to you. Don't spike the ball before you're in the end zone. And Clarence attacks Murphy, who is trapped under a beam, but it doesn't go quite the way he planned.
I am not a RoboCop.
It's pretty epic. I mean, that was a great sequence. I love how Murphy screams when Clarence stabs him. It's disturbing, but it also shows that his human side is really back. And Lewis says, "Murphy, I'm a mess." And Murphy just says, "They'll fix you. They fix everything." Which is kind of an ominous response. But in any case, he pushes the beam off and he heads to OCP headquarters to take care of Dick Jones once and for all. He runs into the Ed 209 again, and it's going to shoot Murphy over a parking violation. But thankfully, Murphy destroys it with one of the assault cannons. Look how they massacred my boy again. And Murphy walks in.
Aggressive attitude.
See? What did I tell you? Every time he walks through double doors, it comes with a weird synthy sound. I don't know why, but I love it. And they're in the middle of a meeting once again, and Murphy tells everyone here that Dick Jones is wanted for murder. He uses his bloody data spike to show Jones admitting to the murder of Bob Morton. Murphy also says that his programming will not allow him to act against an officer of this company. So Jones grabs the Desert Eagle handgun, which once again is just sitting in this room. Anyone can pick it up at any time and shoot someone, apparently. And he takes the old man hostage. And then this happens.
Dick, you're fired!
Thank you.
I love it. It's such a hilariously bad special effect. And I don't think there's many bad special effects in this movie at all. I think they're mostly pretty awesome. But that was atrocious. I mean, why does he have spaghetti arms? It's so weird. And Johnson gives the silliest thumbs up in movie history. I guess he really hated Dick Jones too. And he's probably getting a promotion now. So of course he's happy. And this is just yet another reason why Dick Jones is an idiot, because not only did he willingly admit that he murdered someone to a walking, talking recording device, but he also takes the old man hostage when he probably should have just shot him right there. Because Murphy can't arrest an OCP executive, and the old man is the only person in the room that can make Dick Jones no longer an OCP executive. So if he just shot the old man, Murphy wouldn't be able to do anything. And Dick Jones could probably just walk out the front door. But whatever. Leave it to me to be more of a criminal mastermind than the head villain of this movie. In any case, the old man compliments Murphy on his shooting. And this is how the movie ends.
Nice shooting, son. What's your name?
Murphy.
It's amazing. It's such an outstanding movie. It's just one of those movies that I can almost watch on a loop because it's so well done. A movie with this title and plot has no business being this good. It really doesn't. It should have just been a B movie that kind of came and went. But it's deep, it's profound, and hilarious all at the same time. And because it's so much like a superhero movie, it makes me actually frustrated when I look at some modern superhero movies, especially in the last few years. Like, I just look at guys like Kevin Feige or Zack Snyder or Avi Arad, and I feel like Obadiah Stane, you know? Paul Verhoeven built this in a cave with a bunch of scraps. You know what I mean? It's like, why can't they do something like this now? I don't know. And unfortunately, the RoboCop sequels were never anything special. I like RoboCop 2. It's a fun movie, and it might actually have more humor in it than the first one. But it's frustrating because Murphy kind of regresses back to being more robotic. And the third one is just a mess. It doesn't even have Peter Weller playing the role anymore, and it's just not the same without him. It's also PG-13, and almost all the satire and violence is gone. And RoboCop just flies around in a jetpack. It's just not good. But a RoboCop video game was released at the end of last year, and it's called RoboCop Rogue City, and it's great if you're a RoboCop fan. Peter Weller returns to provide the voice of RoboCop, and it may not be the best first-person shooter in the world as far as mechanics and gameplay goes, but it's a lot of fun, and it really does make you feel like RoboCop. And the story is what the sequel should have been. Taking down OCP once and for all is kind of where the story should have went. And you kind of got that in RoboCop 3, but it was wildly unsatisfying. So if you like RoboCop and you play video games, I can't recommend that game enough. It was a lot of fun. And obviously RoboCop came out in the 80s, which means that despite not being a kids movie, it had a lot of spin-offs and merchandise geared towards kids. They were action figures, a cartoon show, which is not surprising really, because even Rambo had his own Saturday morning cartoon for a while. What can I say? The 80s were just fucking wild. But I should probably wrap this up, don't you think? I have talked way too long about this movie, and I apologize, but that's just how much I love it. But if you managed to stick around this long, thanks for listening. And let me know what you think of this movie. And until next time, take it easy.
Come quietly, or there will be trouble.
You stole that from RoboCop.
That's RoboCop.